speakers.
Now, it's a pleasure for me to announce our next speaker, Professor Theisen from the Sports Medicine Research Lab at the Luxembourg Institute of Health. His title will be Cardiovascular Function During Exercise, the Spinal Cord Injury Model. Please welcome with me Professor Theisen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this nice announcement, and also many thanks to the organizers for having invited me to this plenary session, and also for giving this topic of spinal cord injury a specific highlight through this session. So the question I would like to address today is, in how far can we learn something about cardiovascular functioning during exercise based on the situation of spinal cord injury? And I think Reggie very elegantly touched upon the very technical aspects of the spinal cord and the plasticity, and I will go more into the details of the cardiovascular function of those who still have to rely on their upper body musculature. I have no interest to disclose. An injury to the spinal cord can be the result of a trauma or a congenital situation and results in essentially three conditions: the loss of motor control caudally to the lesion level, the loss of deep and superficial sensitivity, and also loss of autonomic nervous system control. And this is an aspect that has been neglected for quite a while in the domain of exercise physiology, and there is some new exciting recent research around that. Generally, we distinguish between complete and incomplete spinal cord lesions, and when I say this, very often people only refer to the motor control and the sensitivity aspects of this completeness. The loss of motor control can result into tetraplegia, and that would mean a cervical spinal cord lesion, so anywhere between down to the level of cervical 8, and as the name suggests, you would have an impairment also at the upper limbs and at the very least at the hand function. Then you would have a level of high paraplegia, which would, for the sake of this presentation, be defined as the thoracic 5, thoracic 6 level, and then low paraplegia, anything below this. The definition will be some sort of motor score that is based on the motor function of key muscles that still have a functional aspect that is a level 3 on the 5 levels of motor testing. Regarding the sensory score, it's also possible to evaluate sensitivity, and there we look at the dermatomes that are innervated from the different levels of the spinal cord, and eventually there's then also the autonomic nervous system that is now, or has been recently suggested to be more systematically evaluated in the clinical setting. And this is a particularly important aspect because from the point of view of exercise physiology, we're looking at blood pressure regulation, cardiac function, and thermoregulation. Of course, there are other aspects that are very important, but which I will not address today. One way to evaluate the autonomic nervous system completeness, although it's still at a rather experimental stage, is to use what they call sympathetic skin response tests. The principle is quite simple. You stimulate a nerve at the periphery, very often the median nerve, and then you record distally on the four limbs the sympathetic skin response, which is related to the pseudomotor response and acts as a proxy to the integrity of the autonomic nervous system. If you repeat this experiment several times, you can elaborate a sympathetic skin response score, which then tells you something about the integrity of the autonomic nervous system. I'll leave that here for the moment. I'll come back to it in a few minutes. So let's have a look at blood pressure control in individuals with spinal cord injury. Here we have a study that looked at Paralympic athletes, 52 Paralympic athletes with different lesion levels, thoracic 6 to lumbar 2, so I would qualify that as low level paraplegia, thoracic 1 to thoracic 5, high level paraplegia, and then low level cervical lesions, high level cervical lesions. And the test that was applied here is very simple. You take the blood pressure in the supine position after 10 minutes rest, and then you take it again during different time intervals while the individual is positioned in the seated position. And here are the results for the low level and the high level paraplegic individuals, and you see that the point zero is the one at rest in the supine position, and you can see that systolic blood pressure is nicely stabilized or even slightly increases in those with low level paraplegia. Now what's happening to those with cervical lesions? Here are the results. You see that throughout the minutes following the change of position, you have a decrease in systolic blood pressure, which means that these individuals are subject to orthostatic hypotension. And if you look at the delta, so the difference of systolic blood pressure from rest towards the 10th minute, you see that this decrease is highest in those with high cervical lesions, and that is lowest with those with low level paraplegia. Another way to look at this data, instead of taking lesion level as a stratification variable, we take the results from the sympathetic skin responses. And we can argue that any score that would be 0 or 1 from their methodology that was elaborated would represent an absence of autonomic control below the lesion. So we have a complete lesion of the autonomic nervous system, and you see that similarly to lesion level at the cervical level, you have a decrease of systolic blood pressure. So another way to read this is to look at the integrity of the autonomic nervous system, and we can see very nicely that the integrity is very important in the stabilization of blood pressure. Blood pressure control is thus related to the level of spinal cord injury and the integrity of the autonomic nervous system. Now, what's happening during exercise? Here we have systolic blood pressure at rest and at the end of maximal exercise, and we have this in a group of individuals with thoracic lesions, and you see that at the end of exercise, blood pressure is elevated, and then throughout the minutes following exercise, returns to baseline values. If we compare these results to those obtained in individuals with cervical lesions, the first thing you notice is that at rest, we have lower systolic blood pressure, and at the end of exercise, we even have a lower systolic blood pressure, which then recovers in the minutes following exercise. And this means then that individuals with cervical spinal lesions can actually have hypotension following exercise, a condition that has been well described already. Now, let's have a look at cardiovascular function during exercise. And here we have a study from Maria Hopman from the 90s, looking at individuals with only paraplegia, so low-level spinal cord injury, and she compared their results to those of able-bodied individuals. And here we're looking at cardiac output as a function of oxygen uptake. And as you can see, the two groups have similar cardiac output values for submaximal exercise situations. I think this was 40, 60, and 80% of individual exercise, maximal exercise intensity. If you look further into the details of how these cardiac output values were achieved, you can find that the mechanism is quite different. Cardiac stroke volume here, as a function of oxygen uptake, is systematically higher in individuals who are able-bodied and lower in those with paraplegia. And as a compensation mechanism, individuals with paraplegia need to increase their heart rate during submaximal exercise. So there is clearly a physiological disadvantage for those individuals if they want to reach similar performance. Now, why do we have these low cardiac stroke volumes? One of the reasons is probably that we have a lack of venous return, lower cardiac preload, and therefore lower cardiac stroke volume. And we have a few data that indicate that there is a lack of blood redistribution during exercise. Here we have a study where we looked at 3 minutes arm cranking, and we looked at skin blood flow in the leg using laser Doppler flowmetry. And you have here the results in blue of an able-bodied group, and you see that skin blood flow in this group decreases as a result of shunting blood from inactive territories to the active upper body musculature. This was not the case in individuals with medium-level paraplegia and neither in those with low-level paraplegia. So we don't have this vasoconstriction at the periphery that would support blood redistribution for efficient cardiac function. Another study here that looked at portal vein blood flow as a result of exercise, and we have here measurements taken at different time points during exercise, or rather they stopped exercise to take those measurements, and we have here the two curves of the able-bodied and low-level paraplegic individuals, and you can see that in black here we have a decrease of portal vein blood flow throughout exercise. Such a decrease was not noted in this group here, and these are individuals with high lesion levels, that is thoracic 1 to thoracic 5 or thoracic 6. So no change in blood redistribution here for the high lesion individuals, and we have a change for those who have good innervation to the splanchnic bed. The interaction term here was not significant, and I think you would agree that considering the low number of participants, we probably are here facing a problem of statistical power. So if you increase those subjects, I'm quite convinced that you would reach a significant difference there. So we can take an intermediate conclusion, and we know that now with spinal cord injury, we have impaired blood redistribution capacity, which can lead to problems with blood pressure control at rest and during or after exercise, especially in those with cervical lesions. We also have an altered heart rate stroke volume relationship in the sense that venous return is impeded and we have to ramp up heart rate to compensate for this. This may work well for submaximal conditions. Once it comes to maximal conditions, like in elite sports, we of course face a clear disadvantage there. And it's probably related, this impairment, to the lesion level and the completeness. Let's look more closely at cardiac function. Here I compiled the results of 15 studies and I subdivided them in those that are not upper body trained to start with. And we have results from individuals with tetraplegia, high-level paraplegia, again the threshold here was thoracic 5, thoracic 6, low-level paraplegia, so any lesion below that level, and able-bodied control. And you can see here the VO2 peak that was recorded during maximal exercise tests in these situations, and you see a nice inverse relationship between the lesion level and the VO2 peak that can be achieved during voluntary arm cranking exercise. What you notice is that individuals with cervical lesions have the lowest VO2 peak, really very low, 14 milliliters per minute per kilogram, which is excessively low. The reason why this is probably strongly related to heart rate, the peak of which is around 120 beats per minute for individuals with tetraplegia. And this represents approximately 65% of the theoretically predicted maximal heart rate. When you look at individuals with high-level paraplegia, you also see that peak heart rate is limited, 170, approximately 90% of the predicted maximum, and then we have a normalization of those with low-level paraplegia. What happens if you look at trained individuals? So here's the rest of the table, upper body trained individuals, again those four divisions, and we have again an inverse relationship regarding the injury level. So the higher the injury level, the lower the VO2 peak will be. What about heart rate? Well, it seems that it's possible to train this somehow and to reach actually slightly higher peak heart rates. But I think you would agree that this is still quite low as peak heart rate during voluntary exercise. There may still be some deficit present here for individuals with high-level paraplegia, and we have a normal response with those with low-level paraplegia. Now these are a combination of studies. Let's look at one study here which I found and that tested individuals with tetraplegia, paraplegia or no spinal cord injury within the same experimental design. And we're looking here at national level athletes who train approximately 12 to 14 hours per week. And again we have here the lowest VO2 peak in individuals with tetraplegia, moderate results for paraplegics, and then the highest results for those who do not have a spinal cord lesion. Again, we seem to have a clear relation to peak heart rate, and we have approximately, again, 130 beats per minute as maximal heart rate in individuals with tetraplegia. And again, these are high-level elite players, these are rugby players, and we still have this strong limitation in peak heart rate. And the reason why we have this strong limitation becomes obvious when you look at the different divisions of the sympathetic or the parasympathetic nervous system and their innervations. We have the parasympathetic division here, which innervates the heart, and of course the cranial nerve 10, the vagus nerve, still innervates the heart. It is not concerned by the spinal cord lesion. The cranial nerve 10 tends to slow down the heart during at rest. When you start exercising, there is parasympathetic withdrawal, and the heart starts to beat faster. And of a certain exercise intensity, you need to add this sympathetic drive, and the chronotropic and inotropic effect comes from the thoracolumbar division, that is nerve roots emerging between thoracic 1 and thoracic 5. So you can very easily imagine that a lesion between those two areas, thoracic 1 and thoracic 5, will give at least a partial impairment in terms of chronotropic and inotropic effect. And those with cervical lesions only have to rely on parasympathetic withdrawal to increase their heart rate. And we understand, therefore, why maximal heart rate during maximal exercise cannot be much higher than what we've seen in those prior studies. Let's have a look at the sport field. And here we have probably a situation with the best ecological validity in this study that was done on 23 elite paracycling athletes. We're looking at individuals with lesions between cervical 5 and thoracic 8, and these recordings were made during the 2013 World Championships in paracycling. And these were happening in Baie-Comeau, and Christopher West and his team managed to convince these athletes to take on board, or at least some athletes, to take on board a recording device to record their heart rate and also a GPS to record the velocity of their time trial. And as expected, we see that the time trial time is higher in those athletes with cervical lesions compared to those with thoracic lesions. This is no surprise. And by the way, the IPC classification system foresees that these athletes not compete within the same class. So they are well in two different classes, and this is good. Average heart rate was significantly lower in those with cervical lesions compared to those athletes with thoracic lesions. This is also not unexpected, especially if you know the situation with the autonomic nervous system and the different influences. However, you can see that heart rate, even the average values, were quite high for some of these individuals. So what they did, they stratified further their sample into those with complete lesions to the autonomic nervous system and those with incomplete lesions to the autonomic nervous system based on the sympathetic skin response test. And what you see very clearly here is that for those with cervical lesions, you can see that those who have an incomplete lesion with regards to the autonomic nervous system, the time trial results are significantly better than the others. And you also see, but they did not run any statistics on here because the numbers were too low, you can see that on average the heart rate is lower if you have a complete lesion to the autonomic nervous system. So the performance, at least in paracycling in this situation, was critically related to the completeness of the autonomic nervous system. Let's look at another sport, wheelchair rugby. I don't know if you had the occasion ever to look at wheelchair rugby. If not, I really recommend this. It's a terrific sport. It's really very high action, very intense, and it's very often played, mainly played by individuals with cervical spinal cord lesion, who, depending on their functional capacity, will receive a point value between 0.5 and 3.5. Each team is composed of four players, so you play four against four, and the team may have a maximum of 8 points at each time on court. So in this study, seven national level wheelchair rugby players were recruited, and they had complete spinal cord injury. And when I say complete, I refer to the clinical classification with regards to the motor score and the sensory score. So it doesn't say anything about the completeness of the autonomic nervous system. They did two tests, a 4-minute push test, maximal push test on the terrain, on the floor of the wheelchair rugby court, and a maximal lab test in the laboratory with VO2 peak measurements. And so according to the classification of the International Wheelchair Rugby Federation, as I say, we have players with different scores, and what they did, they plotted peak heart rate recorded during the field test and the class in which these players were acting, and you can see that the relationship is not very clear. Similar conclusion holds for VO2 peak measured in the lab as a function of these classes. Again, it's not very clear how VO2 peak is determined. At least it doesn't seem to be so strongly influenced by the classes of the wheelchair rugby classification. If you change the x-axis and you use instead the sympathetic skin response score, so a reflection of the degree of completeness of autonomic nervous system paralysis, you can see that you have quite a good relationship between peak heart rate and this skin response score, and the same holds for peak oxygen uptake, which means that wheelchair rugby performance is critically related to the completeness of the autonomic nervous system. So we can have a second set of intermediate conclusions. We have a lack of sympathetic drive to the heart for individuals with lesions above thoracic 5, and especially for those with cervical lesions, which may lead to impaired, that is, blunted heart rate response during exercise, limited endurance capacity, and again, this seems to be related to the lesion level and to the completeness of the lesion. Let's now look at thermoregulation. We all know that if we go to the sauna, it's generally very hot. So here we have a situation, an old study already, where they recorded oral temperature during a sauna session in individuals with different lesion levels, and they recorded also forearm blood flow. If we become very hot, we tend to want to dissipate this heat through increased peripheral vasodilation and through improved sweat response. And this is what you find here, forearm blood flow increases as the core temperature increases. After a certain threshold, you have this very strong reaction here, steep increase in forearm blood flow in able-bodied individuals, and you see that the response is blunted in those with spinal cord injury. This is passive heating. What's happening during exercise? Again, we have arm cranking exercise here. We have oral temperature recorded during a 60-minute session of exercise here, and you see that in able-bodied, oral temperature increases, and as soon as exercise stops, oral temperature decreases. What's happening to individuals with paraplegia? These are the open diamonds, also an increase to that exercise. There seems to be stabilization here, and then again a decrease during recovery. Although I would argue that the decrease is probably less efficient, so there could be a problem there. We have, unfortunately, only an N of 1 individual with cervical lesion tetraplegia. You have a continuous increase of core temperature throughout the exercise. Core temperature even continues to increase after the minutes when exercise is finished, and then remains high for quite a long time. So it seems that these individuals do not have the capacity to thermoregulate as efficiently as individuals who have no spinal cord lesion. We found a similar result, also looking at 60 minutes arm cranking here. We looked at the changes in esophageal temperature, and we saw that in able-bodied, after 60 minutes arm cranking, I think it was 50% of individual maximum, we see a nice stabilization of core temperature, and we see that in the two other groups, that is medium level and low level paraplegia, we have an increase and eventually higher core temperature change compared to able-bodied. And the reason why we have this accumulated body heat is because we do not have the large increase in skin blood flow in the legs. So this was recorded in the legs, with no autonomic innervation in those with paraplegia, here in red and green. And you can see the very sharp increase of leg skin blood flow with the able-bodied individuals for an efficient dissipation of the extra body heat. When you look at skin temperature also in the legs, you can see that the able-bodied are capable of decreasing the skin temperature, and the mechanism is something that you all know. It's by producing sweat that via evaporation from the skin will cool the skin down by about 1.5 degrees on average, and you see that this effect is not present in those with paraplegia. In other words, they have no capacity to sweat below the lesion level. So we have an impaired thermoregulatory response, and this will likely lead to greater risk of hypothermia through greater exercise-induced thermal strain. And this again is related to the lesion level and the completeness of the lesion. So in summary, I think we can learn many lessons about cardiovascular function when we take the situation of spinal cord injury and we consider it as a model to study the different functions that are still present and that are absent. We know that cardiovascular function is critically dependent on the integrity of the autonomic nervous system, and this is also a very important aspect in paracycling, wheelchair rugby, and any Paralympic sports for individuals with spinal cord injury. Autonomic function is an important determinant of sports performance, and we probably should look at implementing evaluation of autonomic nervous function into classification of disabled sports. I'd like to thank my team from the Luxembourg Institute of Health, who have to support me on a daily basis, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Theisen, for this really interesting data, I think also with a lot of implications for the practical aspect. We have time for a discussion, so the floor is open, please. If there are any questions, go to the micro and ask your question, please.
So maybe while you are going to the microphone, oh, I see Martin Flück is ready to ask a question.
Yeah, hi, Nikki. Yes, I have a question to both of them. I didn't actually see that you consider vasomotor control, so perfusion, to be a factor, neither in the studies presented by Richie Edgerton, really nice studies. He alluded to motor units, and also here it was not fully addressed. So what is the contribution of contraction-induced dilatation of arterioles to perfuse muscle, also for sweating, to the observations that you have made conceptually? Maybe first Richie Edgerton, I don't know if you can comment if it's really a fiber type issue, that your RER, for instance, that you showed, or whether may perfusion plays a role that's only induced if you do voluntarily contract, because you activate or induce dilatation.
Earlier, some years ago, Herman and his colleagues with two subjects that were studied in Arizona that were incomplete and could walk, they had some data actually similar to what I showed with respect to their CO2-O2 ratios, indicating that there was relatively normal recruitment order of motor units when they were stimulating the spinal cord. Our observations in general is that it's true when we don't stimulate at high levels. In other words, when we just enable rather than actually induce the movement. So it looks like the mechanisms within the spinal cord are capable of operating based on its usual principles of recruitment of order. Of course, there's the other issue that you raise is it's been demonstrated that over a year and sometimes several years, the phenotype of the muscle becomes fast or faster in terms of the type of myosin. There's data that's a little confusing here, but this does not occur very rapidly. And how that is going to affect blood flow is unclear. I think the blood flow issue is extremely important. One of the things that we see very early in these patients is that their tolerance to changes in ambient temperature is much improved. But also, even earlier, their sense of the temperature of their skin and the rate at which it can recover when it gets cooled, and then they cover themselves with a blanket. Those adaptations are pretty significant also. So the mechanisms behind this cardiovascular circulatory mechanism relative to the training and the stimulation, I think is fascinating, and I'd love to be able to know more about that. But maybe I talked about your problem but not address it, I'm not sure.
Maybe just an add-on to this. All the data that I presented here are those from voluntary muscle work of the upper body. So you would expect the normal vasoconstrictive reaction at the beginning of exercise, but then as body heat builds up, you have a superseding vasodilation at the periphery. And this is obviously not present. Neither of the two reflexes seem to work very well below the lesion level or at all. Again, the results I showed here on the vasomotor responses, we did not check for the integrity of autonomic nervous system. So we would actually have to go back to those individuals and test that, and then maybe stratify our results according to that variable.
I think that's all, I think, addressing most. I just tell you that there are recent data that the angiotensin II levels are intensity-dependent raised, and the levels control, in fact, RER during exercise. So I think we're touching the point. We probably need more discussion.
We have another question from Inge Zedewin from Groningen.
Thank you. For your excellent presentation. I have another question concerning neuromodulation, because besides the autonomic nervous system and the voluntary control, we also have a control of neuromodulation. For instance, if you look at serotonin and the lack of serotonin in people with spinal cord injury, two motor neurons, for instance, make the motor neurons change, and they have some sort of consecutive activation of serotonin receptors. Are those processes also known for the autonomic nervous system? Are there changes in receptors, and are there changes in how the cells respond? And what sort of receptors are we thinking of that? I can imagine that, for instance, for adrenaline and noradrenaline, the receptors maybe also change if you have a difference in sympathetic activation.
Do you mind? So what is quite well accepted is that after a spinal cord injury, you have a denervation the receptors are desensitized, and probably there is a decrease in the number of receptors, and this is also a phenomenon that is very nicely observed in the phenomenon of autonomic dysreflexia, which I haven't talked about here, but see an increase in adrenaline and noradrenaline during those episodes, and a very strong vasoconstriction peripherally. So I would expect a downregulation of either receptors or the sensitivity of these receptors regarding vasomotor aspects.
I think it's not clear what happens to the receptors. There's multiple receptors, serotonergic and other monoamine receptors that are important, and there's a combination of these drugs that will give you the best result in terms of regaining motor control. The thing that's interesting about the neuromodulation of the pharmacology versus the stimulation, we think that they're working through complementary mechanisms, which is an advantage. The effect of the two together work very synergistically. You can get better effects with both of them. I think some of the animal data suggests that there's initially a rise in some of the receptors and then a decline. The animal experiments, we have found that the dosage that of serotonergic agonists that, we give changes very little over time as they're learning to, as they're relearning how to step. But obviously the receptor situation is a very important one that we don't nearly know enough about, but there are multiple receptors that are imported in serotonergic receptors that are imported in locomotion. And I think some of the initial drug testing is probably going to prove that to be relevant in humans as well.
And I ask one naive question. So Reggie, when you stimulated the spinal cord, of course you were relying on the fact that you still have some circuits that are intact below the lesion and that can function quite autonomously to produce movement. Now with the autonomic nervous system, do we know whether there are also some circuits still intact that don't need the input from the brain? And when you would now apply the electrical stimulation to higher areas, would you see a response in blood pressure regulation or other vegetative functions? It's a thought experiment here.
I think there is actually some data in the area of neuromuscular stimulation. So it's an exercise paradigm whereby you have individuals with a spinal cord injury cycle on a recombinant bicycle ergometer with stimulations to the lower limb muscles, which are paralyzed. And it seems that it does bring about some adaptations, at least on the muscle tissue level, some fiber type changes, some increases in certain fiber, in certain enzyme activities. There's also an acute adaptation to exercise in the sense that you increase your VO2, but you have also a very sharp increase in VCO2, and then it's some throughout the exercise session it stabilizes. But it's something that only works in some individuals where obviously the relay at the spinal cord is functioning for muscles to be responsive. If you are looking at longitudinal lesions where you don't have the relay anymore, they will not be responsive to electrical stimulation. And yes, I would argue that the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system, they have some degree of autonomous function without the superior control centers intervening.
I think it's pretty well known now that there's a tremendous amount of overlap in the sensory information going back to the spinal cord of the autonomic system and the motor system. It's pretty amazing. In fact, there's a clinical technique that's used to improve bladder function that's stimulating the tibial nerve that's being used now. And in my own opinion, this matter of automoticity is suggesting to me that given the autonomic system is pretty automatic compared to the motor system, that the autonomic system may be an easier target if we can identify what those circuits are. And NIH has put in a lot of emphasis in funding projects that's trying to identify that circuitry. But when we stimulate the lumbosacral spinal cord, we're stimulating those circuits that's related to sexual function, bowel function, and bladder function, and obviously cardiovascular and blood flow. So all of those systems, those autonomic systems, are somehow coming into play. I think they're relatively dormant. They're not used to getting the excitation that they have been. So I think there's a lot of potential for the autonomic system.
Right. Thank you very much. And we probably have time for one last quick question and a quick answer.
Make it short. My name is Charlotte Sweter, University of Copenhagen. Thank you for a great session. I have a question for Dr. Edison. Do you know if anyone tried to use epidural electrical stimulation in the acute phase or the initial phase after injury?
In the early stages, no. That's an extremely interesting question. I think everyone theoretically would say that if you start the stimulation earlier after the injury, you may get greater recovery and less of a decline in function. The reason we use the standard of greater than 1 year, as we figured whatever change we got after a year, it couldn't be, according to the standard thought, no change can occur after a year, so whatever we saw, it could be attributed to our intervention. That was the logic. I think this is certainly an important question that needs to be addressed. But at the same time, with TBI, stroke, and spinal cord injury, there's evidence that you can start too early. So I think that those are very important issues that we need to address.
Okay, thank you very much. It's sync time.